Ladies and gentlemen, today we're going to be talking about the atmosphere.
There are many differences between our Earth and other known planets, but one of the most significant would be the presence of an atmosphere surrounding our planet.
Well, what does the atmosphere do?
I don't know. What does it do?
Well, funny you ask, because our very intelligent professor, Mr. Pittman...
Don't forget Ansem.
He actually just taught us this. So, the atmosphere actually supplies most of the oxygen needed for animals to survive. It also, also the carbon dioxide needed by the plants. It helps maintaining a water supply, you know, because of the rain and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, we need water for living things to live. It's also working like a shield to protect the Earth from much of the sun's ultraviolet radiation. So, essentially, it's the atmosphere basically that makes life possible here on Earth.
Well, one common synonym for the atmosphere is air. But what it really is a mixture of numerous different gases. The two most abundant, which would be nitrogen and oxygen. Nitrogen makes up about 78% of the total, and oxygen about 21%. But nitrogen is added into the air through processes like chemical breakdown of certain rocks, burning organic matter, and volcanic eruption. At the same time, being removed by certain biological processes and by being washed away through rain and snow and that kind of stuff. But overall, the addition and removal of nitrogen are balanced, so therefore the quantity presented in the air remains the same over time.
Same.
Oxygen is produced by vegetation and is removed by a variety of organic processes, and the same as with nitrogen. The total quantity is also remains stable. The other gases that are included in that last little 1% would be argon, neon, helium, krypton, and hydrogen.
So, do you know the size of the atmosphere?
Can't be much bigger than this room, right?
Pretty sure it's a lot bigger than that, bro.
No?
Yeah, it's obviously hard. It's hard to tell because all the gases that make up the atmosphere are invisible. But the atmosphere actually extends outward of approximately 6,000 miles. Pretty far.
I've never ran that far before.
Okay.
Anyway, keep going.
Alright, okay, so, and the atmosphere is held to Earth by gravitational attraction. Hey, fun fact. Want a fun fact?
I got a fun fact.
You got
it? I got a fun fact.
Okay.
More than half of the atmosphere's mass lies below the elevation of the highest mountaintop in America.
Which one's that?
Which is, I'm pretty sure it's Mount McKinley.
It's definitely Mount McKinley.
McKinley.
Yeah.
In Alaska, and it's at an elevation of about 3.8 miles. More than 98% of the Earth's atmosphere's mass is within 16 miles of sea level. It's pretty crazy.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's cool stuff. Atmosphere is cool.
Yeah. Did you know there are various different layers of atmosphere?
Are you asking me this?
I'm quizzing you this.
Yeah, I know.
Okay, prove it.
Oh, okay. Well, there's five. We got the exosphere. We have a thermosphere, mesosphere, stratosphere, and troposphere. And troposphere being the closest one to the Earth.
Well done. Okay.
Yeah. So most of us have had some type of experience, I'm pretty sure, with a difference in temperature depending on altitude.
Okay.
Meaning that, say, if you climb a mountain, it's going to get colder the higher up you climb.
Definitely.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, this is true, especially because of the first layer of the atmosphere, which is the troposphere, like I just said. The sun heats the surface of the Earth, which heats the lower part of the troposphere.
The stratosphere, the second layer, temperature increases with increasing altitude and reaches near ground level temperatures at heights over 30 miles. This is because the ozone at this level absorbs UV radiation from the sun.
Hmm. Well, in the mesosphere, which is the third one, the temperature decreases dramatically to temperatures as low as minus 130 degrees.
Ooh.
It's pretty cold. It's pretty cold.
Chilly.
The thermosphere, which is the fourth one, it goes up pretty high. We're talking like 310 miles above the surface. This one's the hot layer.
Can't be hotter than Mr. Pittman.
Because there's relatively few oxygen atoms that absorbs the solar energy. So it heats really fast, and also it changes dramatically in response to changing solar activity.
Okay.
Yeah. Hey, bro.
What up, Mike?
Bro, so I just got this idea here, right? So wouldn't it be kind of cool to actually go up there and like kind of see the atmosphere in first person?
Like getting
experience
high.
The atmosphere.
You're talking about smoking marijuana?
Huh?
What are you talking about? Like getting high?
Not right now.
You're talking about like first-hand experience?
Yeah.
Oh.
So I'm saying, like, I'm talking like skydive type of stuff.
Listen,
get up
listen,
there,
listen,
just
listen,
jump
listen,
and like
listen,
feel
listen,
it,
listen.
Just be like.
Listen, listen, listen. You can do that. See, I personally find like a video is good for me. I see no reason to jump out of a perfectly good airplane. You know what I'm saying? It's gonna land. Why jump out of it?
Too bad for you.
No!
Well, Gus, it could be a lot worse.
Come on!
Nah, I'm just messing with you.
Not cool. Not cool.
So, yeah, Gus is gonna be jumping out of a plane, which is kinda cool. So I'll be rocking this solo. I'm gonna be talking more about, you know, skydiving type of stuff, which I feel like is more interesting. But so what he's gonna do is gonna get ready and he's gonna get up in that plane. He's gonna be jumping out of that plane at approximately 13,000 feet. So hopefully we're gonna be getting some real good pictures of the curvature of the Earth. So for all of you who still believe the Earth is flat, we're gonna have proof that it's not. So how Gus, how you feeling? Are you excited?
No, no.
Okay, good. So obviously Gus is really excited. But does he have anything to be worried about? Is it really safe or is it not? Well, one of the things that is actually really dangerous for skydivers is turbulence. And this is because if a skydiver gets caught in a downward flow of air, it will accelerate the parachute towards the ground, which I guess could result in injury or death. So due to turbulence, this is actually one of the reasons why skydivers typically don't jump out of planes when there are winds more than 20 to 30 miles an hour. All right, so let's check up with Gus again. Let's see how he's doing. How are you doing, Gus?
I just got a zero.
The reason is I just want to see if he can get into the plane.
Is there ever too many rides?
So skydive facts, as Gus is getting ready sitting on the plane, so what's gonna happen when he's up there? Well, as a skydiver jumps out of a plane, he's gonna start, obviously start accelerating due to the force of gravity. It's gonna pull him down. So as he speeds up, the upward air resistance force increases. He's gonna keep accelerating for as long as the air resistance is less than his weight. Eventually he's gonna reach what's called terminal speed, and this is when the air resistance and his own weight becomes equal, meaning that he's reached maximum speed. When the parachute opens, it's gonna have a large surface area, which is gonna increase the air resistance. So this unbalances the forces and causes Gus to slow down. Oh, what's that studio? Okay, sounds like Gus is ready to jump. So let's check it out.
She's a good girl, loves her mama, loves Jesus. In America too, she's a good girl. She's crazy about Elvis, loves horses, and her boyfriend too.
Yeah, buddy! How exciting was that? Was that pretty fun?
Screw it. I'm done with this project.
Well, that's cool, because we're done anyways.